be appropriate. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
What a day. What a day. Let me just read a little bit of the account. From the Gospel of John. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb while it was still dark and saw the stone already taken away from the tomb. And so she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter therefore went forth and the other disciple, and they were going to the tomb. And the two were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter, and came to the tomb first. And stooping and looking in, he saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Simon Peter therefore also came, following him, and entered the tomb, and he beheld the linen wrappings lying there, and the face cloth which had been on his head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. So the other disciple who had come first to the tomb entered then also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. So the disciples went away to their own homes. But Mary was standing outside the tomb weeping. And so as she wept, she stooped and looked into the tomb. And she beheld two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet, where the body of Jesus had been lying. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and beheld Jesus standing there, and did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Stop clinging to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to my Father and your Father, and my God and your God." Mary Magdalene came announcing to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that she had, and that he had said these things to her. Let's pray. Father, we are humbled in your presence this morning. Even the reading of these words, Lord, brings awe to our hearts, Father, and it also brings joy. Father, this account is something that the world has never known other than with this. And Father, we praise you. We thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice that you made for the sins of the entire world. Father, we thank you for that point in time when you called each of our names, Lord, and made us aware of our need for salvation. And Lord, your Spirit drew us to you, and your loving kindness brought us to repentance. We've never been the same, Father, and we thank you for that. Now, Lord, on this Easter morning, as we pass people who are going about their business, just doing the normal things, we ask that you would awaken this same need within them. Father, they're no different from us. We could be the ones, Lord, going to the gym this morning or going to anywhere else, Father, but we ask that you would stir their hearts, that you would convict each one, Lord, concerning sin, righteousness, and coming judgment, and that your loving kindness would bring them to repentance. Lord, we've come to worship you today. Please prepare our hearts, Father, that we would not go through the motions, Lord, but that we would truly worship you in spirit and in truth and give you the honor that is due you. Lord, work a work in our hearts as we hear your word taught this morning, as we sing about you, and hear the message that both Jim and our pastor will bring. Work a work, Lord, so that as we go forth this week, we will shine for you. Help us to be attentive to promptings that you may give our hearts, Father. Order our steps so that they will count for all eternity. For it is in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior, that we pray this. Amen. I saw Miss Sarah. Hey, Sarah. Okay. Well, Sarah is going to lead us this morning in two special hymns about the resurrection. And I believe Gladine has written those numbers up there. If you could see behind the palm tree here, it's 114 and 438. 114. Sarah coming to lead us in.
Okay. If I keep on singing, it's because I'm having a solo. I'm going to make one glad he would dance with me. I'm singing a solo. Didn't you remember that? Okay. All right. 114, and we're going to do all three verses of each, right?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, guess what? He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Okay. Pardon me for being out of bed. I've been here since what time did we do in your garden? Anyway,
early.
This place is long and wide. Anyway, okay. Christ the Lord is risen today. Oh, which verse shall we do? Did you say all four or just three of each?
Let's do all four.
Okay. All right, guys.
Raise your joys and triumph.
Oh, and I learned this song at Gloria at a home missions week, and I was a teenager, and I went to a signing class. This was the first song and only song I ever learned. So, I don't know. Once I say a word or two, then
good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Easter Sunday. We have a member emeritus that's returned to us this morning. Ed's here. This morning I'm going to talk to you about the resurrection. The resurrection from the dead. A dead body in a tomb for 3 days and 3 nights. And on that Sunday morning, breath came back, a heart began to pump, lungs filled with air, blood began to circulate, and a corpse came back to life. And the Lord Jesus Christ, just as he prophesied he would. You know, it's interesting when you talk about the resurrection from the dead, and you have to say, please understand that our faith is based on this. This is central to the faith. And it's interesting, some polls, I ran across a couple of polls this week. In England, this poll found that 1/4 of English Christian adults did not believe that Jesus literally rose from the dead. Rasmussen Reports did a poll. They found that 64% of Americans believe that Jesus rose from the dead, about 2/3. Only 36% of the 1,000 adults interviewed in a Scripps survey at Ohio State this year said, do you believe after you die that your physical body will be resurrected someday? Only 36%. 54% of them said they did not believe it, and 10% were undecided. Let me read for you 1 Corinthians 15, Apostle Paul, starting at verse 12. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith also is empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. Do you understand the significance of what Paul's saying there? This is not a light matter. This is not a, well, it's not important matter. It's central to our faith. If Christ did not rise from the dead on Easter morning, we're wasting our time. And worse than that, we're all still in our sins. The resurrection of Jesus Christ on Easter is a matter of history. We don't believe it was a hallucination or a dream or a myth. We believe that in real time, in the space-time universe, that Christ rose from the dead on Easter Sunday. Christ, Jesus, a prophet who claimed to be the Christ. He was arrested, judged to be a criminal. He was crucified 3 days after his death and burial. Some women went to his tomb and found the body was gone. In subsequent weeks, his disciples claimed that he had risen from the dead, and that he appeared to them several times before he ascended into heaven. Living witnesses, the people of the first century, the Christians, witnessed the resurrection of Jesus Christ as a real fact, something that took place in history. And they circulated that story everywhere. They were doing it at the time that it happened. From that Sunday forward, they began to preach and teach and witness that Jesus had risen from the dead. Had he not risen from the dead, there were thousands of hostile witnesses there in Jerusalem that could have contested what they said. That did not happen. Let me read for you from Matthew 27, verse 59. When Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and he laid it in his new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock, and he rolled a large stone across the mouth of it. And he departed. That's the burial of Christ in Joseph's tomb. Back then, when someone died, if able, the family would wrap the body. They didn't do embalming back then. They would wrap the body in linen cloths, sort of like you would imagine a mummy is prepared. They would wrap it repeatedly around the limbs and the torso and the head. And with each wrap, they would put a paste of spices to preserve the body and to eliminate the smells as the body lay there. They used, they say, oftentimes up to 100 pounds of spices in those wrappings. Can you imagine? If Christ himself weighed 150 pounds, when they got through with the wrapping, he probably was around 250 pounds with the linen cloths wrapped around his body. They placed him in a rock tomb. Historically, it's called the Garden Tomb. I saw it, stuck my head in it, and witnessed it when on a trip to Israel in 2007. But the interesting thing is, when they put him in there, they prepared those tombs with a large rock that could be rolled, and typically it was rolled downhill. It was not flat. It was a rock that weighed 1.5 to 2 tons, and when they tripped the lever and it rolled in place, it was meant to stay there, obviously. There was no need to come back and open that door again. It was sealed when the rock rolled in place. And that's what Matthew describes for us. Shortly after this happened, the story in the book of the Gospel of Matthew, a thought began to dawn in the Jewish leaders' mind. Some of them remembered that Jesus taught that he would rise from the dead. They remembered he said that. And fearing some sort of conspiracy or fearing deception by the apostles, they didn't believe he was really going to rise from the dead, but they thought perhaps the disciples would come steal the body and say that he rose from the dead. They went to the Romans, they went to Pilate, and they asked him for permission to seal that tomb with a Roman seal and place a guard of Roman soldiers at the entrance to it. Let me read for you. Matthew 27:65. Pilate said to them, "You can have your guard," and that word in Greek stands for 8 Roman soldiers. "Go your way and make it as secure as you know how to." So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone. Now that's very significant. That's a Roman seal. It was a strip of rawhide with an emblem in the middle of it for the Empire of Rome, sealed with wax across the entrance of a door. They sealed the stone, set the guard in place, a Roman guard. There we have it. Now, this tomb, this rock tomb, this hewn out cave of a tomb, was sealed with a Roman seal, and then eight Roman men were placed on 24-hour duty guarding that tomb. It was very important back then to understand the significance of both of those things. A Roman seal, broken by anyone, the penalty was the death penalty. It was not a light thing. You think of the yellow tape that the police string up today, and we see that today. That's nothing compared to what a Roman seal was. When it was put in place, all the power and majesty of Rome was behind it, and you didn't break it. That's why it was there. Furthermore, that 8 guards were placed there on 24-hour duty tells us how seriously they took this idea that perhaps something might happen with that body in the tomb. But 3 days later, that tomb was empty. The followers of Christ, as Kent read to you, the accounts of Mary's and the other disciples, when they looked in there, they all swore that he had risen from the dead. They saw him. They talked to him that Easter morning. And for 40 days, he walked among them there in Jerusalem and in Galilee. And he appeared to them, and he spoke with them. He even ate with them during that period of time. It was a true resurrection from the dead. You know, I had a professor when I was at the seminary that tried to tell me that the resurrection was in spirit. that he didn't bodily rise from the dead. And at that time I thought, gosh, have you ever read the Gospels? Can it be any more clear that his body rose from the dead? We have a physical resurrection from the dead in the Lord Jesus Christ. He appeared at one time during this 40 days, Paul says, to more than 500 people. That's a lot of people, is it not? 500 people there in Jerusalem were at some sort of gathering, and Christ appeared to them in a significant way, because Paul says, if you don't believe me, go talk to them. They're still alive. 1 Corinthians 15:3. For I delivered to you first of all that which also I've received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. He was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. After that, he was seen by Cephas, or Peter, and then by the 12. And after that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. Paul's writing this about 25 years after the resurrection. So some of them have died. After that, he was seen by James, that's his brother, and then by all of the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me, Paul, as one born out of due time. So we see, you know, lots of security precautions were taken by the Romans as well as the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem to stop any hint of this rising from the dead idea coming true. But there's some problems with that. There's some problems. I've got a story I'd like to tell, but I feel pressed for time. You know, the Lord does things sometimes to interrupt the plans of men, does he not? I mean, have you not had that happen? There's a family in our church, a Hispanic family, that a year ago, the father had, he's been here 15 years, has not seen his 86-year-old mother in Mexico for 15 years. And he knew he didn't have long. He wanted to go see her. He was afraid to go see her because afraid he wouldn't be able to come back and take care of his family. But he said, I'm going to go anyway. And his family, his daughters and son and wife, began to pray that the Lord would stop him. They didn't want to lose him. And the next week, he broke his foot at work. And they kind of giggle when they tell the story, because they believe the Lord broke his foot to keep him from doing that. Well, you know, the Lord's good and he's kind and faithful, because that mama got on an airplane and flew up here last week, and she's going to stay up here for 2 months to be with her family. I met her in church last Sunday morning. Wonderful little lady. But when the resurrection happened, the burial of Christ, they did everything in the world they could to stop any hint of anything going on in the way of rising from the dead. But we've got facts. Number one, the first fact we've got is the broken seal. I've mentioned that. That is so obvious to anyone that is a student of Roman history. That was the penalty of death, and no one, no Jew nor Roman, would have dared to break that seal. But that morning, the seal was broken because the stone was gone. It was rolled away from the tomb. The seal had been broken. Rome had been called to account. The Jewish leaders were called to account. Their plans to stop the resurrection fell apart. Fact number two. There was an empty tomb on Easter morning. He was not there. The corpse was gone. Matthew 28:1. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, and an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone. Rolled back in most translations, it says roll back. It's quite, not quite accurate. The word is thrown with force. The angel took that 2-ton stone and threw it away from the door. And then he sat on it in triumph. I like that angel. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And listen to this. The guards all shook for fear of him and became like dead men. Comatose is that word. They went into some type of shock. These were tough Roman soldiers, used to warfare and fighting. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Don't be afraid, because I know you're seeking Jesus, who was crucified, but he's not here, because he's risen, as he said. Come and see the place where he lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples, listen, he's risen from the dead. And indeed, he's going to go on before you all up into Galilee, and there you'll see him. Behold, I told you." Isn't that wonderful? The confidence, the authority of that angel to know what had happened to Christ when he rose from the dead that morning, and he was sitting there in great power while these Roman soldiers are passed out on the ground. An empty tomb means he lives. You know, our disciples that we study and read and love, you know, they didn't go right off to Rome and preach this gospel. They didn't go to Alexandria immediately and preach the gospel, although ultimately they did. Friends, they went right back into Jerusalem, and Golgotha's Hill is less than a mile from the Temple Mount. Right? They went right back into town and began to preach that Jesus was alive, that he had risen from the dead. Now, why is that significant? To me, that's significant because they're saying the tomb is empty, and no one could say otherwise. It was clearly empty, and we see that in the Gospels, because not only did the disciples say it was empty, we've got the Jewish leaders and the Romans confirming that it was empty. We have the Jewish leaders conspiring and bribing those 8 guards with money to tell a lie. It was too notorious to deny that the tomb was empty. It went right back in town, and all anybody had to do was produce the body. Christianity's over with. No one did. No one did. The Jews admit an empty tomb, the Romans admit an empty tomb, and Christians have been preaching an empty tomb for 2,000 years now. Fact number 3, I want to talk about that stone, that big stone that was moved. That was impressive to the people that came. Not only was the seal broken, that stone was out of place. It was not in the track that had been carved into the stone for it to roll in. It was moved forcibly by that angel. You remember what the disciples were like at the cross and the night before? Running away? And you remember that? They were denying him 3 times, one of them. And suddenly, we're going to say, they went up there and broke the seal and overpowered 8 Roman guards. And they picked up a 2-ton rock and threw it and stole a body. Really? I mean, that's the authority, the clarity that the Lord gave to us on resurrection morning. That nothing else can explain what happened other than the fact that he rose from the dead. And he was who he said he was. These Roman guards, you know, in our army, we call it AWOL, when you're absent without leave. It's a serious charge. This is far worse. They failed in their mission to guard that tomb, and the body was gone. They left their responsibilities behind. You know, guards back then, if they failed on guard duty, they would strip their clothing off till they were naked, And then they would take their clothes and wrap it around their feet and start a fire and burn them to death with their clothes. It was serious to go to sleep on guard duty. And yet, they were all found as though asleep. I want to call to your attention another little factoid that we've got in this gospel story, and that is the grave clothes. The grave clothes. John 20, verse 4. They both ran together. This is Peter and John. And the other, well, it says they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter. So we know John won the foot race. He was a fast runner. He came to the tomb first, and stooping down and looking in, he saw the linen cloths lying there. Yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and he went into the tomb, and he saw the linen clothes lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came into the tomb first went in and also, and he saw and he believed. Now I want to call out an item here. There are several Greek scholars, the little phrase there that is used twice, lying there in reference to these grave cloths, they believe that what was trying to be communicated there was that the grave cloth wrapped in the form of a body and appendages was laying there in the same form but collapsed, like a cocoon, the body not in it. That 100 pounds of spices, that when he rose, that the clothes collapsed. The linen clothes were left behind, and certainly we do know his clothes were left behind, and the headscarf. The reason I think they might be onto something is the fact that, if you'll notice what I just read to you in verse 8, it says the other disciple came to the tomb, went in, he saw, and then he believed. And what he see that made him believe? Would seeing grave cloths normally make you believe anything? If you saw a pile of linen cloths unwound and just thrown on the ground, well, you could say, well, someone came and stole the body and they unwound the linen cloths, couldn't you? But to come in and see those cloths lying collapsed in the form of a body defies explanation other than resurrection from the dead. Perhaps that's what happened. We can't be 100% clear on this. There are professors that believe this is what he's trying to say. Others don't see it. But he came in and he saw and he believed. So something's there. I don't think John ever got over it, personally. I don't think he ever got over it, what he saw in that tomb. Because John was a changed man from that time on. He endured the rest of his life and died a martyr's death in Ephesus. And he wasn't willing to back down. He knew what he saw. Do you remember what he says in 1 John? That which we have seen and that we have heard and that we have handled with our hands, that's what we proclaim to you. So something happened in the empty tomb. Next, Jesus appeared to people when he rose from the dead. He didn't just ascend to heaven. He stayed for 40 days and appeared several times to the disciples and to his followers and to the 500 in that crowd. 500. I want to dwell on that a minute. I think it's significant. I think he did that for a reason, to give us indisputable facts in history that cannot be denied. There are people that have been skeptics, there still are, that try to explain away the resurrection of Christ. But when he appeared to 500 men, and then Paul had the audacity to say, if you don't believe me when I tell you that Jesus rose from the dead, go and talk to those 500. Go pick apart their testimony. If you don't believe me, go talk to all of them and see if what I'm telling you is the truth or not. You know, if each one of those 500 testified in court for 6 minutes, you would have 50 hours of firsthand eyewitness testimony to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Some people have said, he didn't really rise, they went to the wrong tomb on Easter morning. There have been books written on this. Those people were stupid. They went to the wrong tomb. Well, the problem with that is you're saying Mary, the several Marys, went to the wrong tomb. You're saying Peter and John went to the wrong tomb.
The Roman guards went to the wrong tomb.
They're next. You're saying the Roman guards had the wrong tomb. No, that doesn't make any sense. Some people have said, well, it was just all a big hallucination, a mass hysteria. People had this hallucination of they were in the upper room and he appeared. That was just a hallucination. The problem with that is you've got people, multiple people that had the same hallucination, and that never happens. It doesn't work that way. And you don't have hallucinations that change a man that would be willing to spend the rest of his life in obscurity preaching the gospel of Christ and die for it that have seen a hallucination. That doesn't change a man. The Muslims say Jesus did not die on the cross, that he just swooned. He reinvigorated. He felt better the next day. But he didn't really die. And that stretches all credibility and just demonstrates how ignorant people are to understand what the crucifixion was to a man. The suffering and the whipping and the scourging beforehand, as well as the nails in the hands, the loss of blood, the collapse of the heart and lungs, the spear in the side, and to say that he felt better the next day and he got up and got out of that tomb somehow and came and found his disciples and did everything and said everything. It's beyond belief. It's beyond credibility. People have said the body was stolen. Somebody stole that body. Well, okay. So if somebody stole that body, and shortly after the resurrection, you've got these disciples going everywhere preaching the resurrection of Jesus Christ for the salvation of mankind and forgiveness of sins. If they stole the body and that was going on, wouldn't they have shown up and said, you guys are liars. Here's the body. If it's the Romans that did it, if it was the Jewish leaders that did it, the enemies of Christ would have produced the body. And they did not. The resurrection is fact. Jesus is alive. He rose from the grave on that Easter morning. You know the real proof of this? It was in that song we just sang a minute ago. I know that he is living, right? He's alive. The testimony of billions, listen to me, billions of people that have been Christians in 2,000 years that have testified, when I asked Jesus to forgive my sins and to come into my heart, he did. Now see, that is the ultimate proof. Changed lives. He's changed our lives, hasn't he? Did something happen when you bowed your knee to him? He's alive. And he comes into people's hearts and has a personal relationship with them today. What happens?
Why was that napkin on his face folded neatly over
there? Doesn't say. I don't know. I thought that same thought last night. I wondered why it was separate from the grave clothes. But I don't know.
Tie it down there.
You know, you wouldn't be able to take that off if you were confined with the grave clothes. He had to, you think, risen and come out of those grave clothes to take that off, but I can't say that's what happened.
When the Jews, before they were having a dinner, and they were through eating,
okay,
they would just throw their napkin on the table,
Okay.
But if they were gonna go to the restroom and then come back and have dessert, they folded their mat before, to show they're coming back.
So it's a Jewish custom.
So that's why he folded that mat before coming back.
He's coming back. Great, I hadn't read that, that's interesting.
You can write that down.
Yeah, I will. I'll use that next Easter. Well, yeah, we've talked about this thing of the resurrection and did it happen or did it not, but as I was saying, lives change when they bow to the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's the proof, that's the ultimate proof. When Jesus rose from the dead, it proved that everything he said was true. He rose from the dead, hear me. A corpse that came back to life. And to do that, he proved that everything he taught is true, which is that he was God in the flesh, that he came to earth to reveal God's will, that he would die on the cross at the hands of sinful men, that he would arise from the dead, as he said, and that he would ascend into heaven, which he did, and that he is going to come back again for his people. That's important. That's tied to the resurrection. Number two, we can all be sure that our sins are forgiven because he rose from the dead. Romans 4:25, Christ was delivered over to death on account of our sins, and he was raised to life on account of our justification. See, the Lord himself says that there. Jesus died on the cross for your sins, and when he rose from the dead, it was God saying, I forgive you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. It was God saying, that's the payment right there. Now they can all be forgiven and come into my family. Number three, the resurrection of Jesus Christ means that those that believe in him will also rise from the dead one day. There it is. That's us. We have a hope based on the historical resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, that like he rose, so will we. Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life, and he who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. John 11:25. You see it there? What Jesus said was, because I have risen from the dead, I can cause you to arise from the dead. There's coming a day, he said, when those that sleep in the graves will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those that hear will rise. They'll come back. Lastly, the resurrection of Jesus Christ means, very simply, that every man, woman, boy, and girl has got a decision to make. If this is true, Jesus is the only way to heaven, because he is the only one that died and paid for sin and rose from the dead with God's approval. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me. We want to be saved and escape the wrath of God, have eternal life. We have to repent of our sins and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ for our salvation. That's what the resurrection is about. People might say, where is God? We don't have to say that anymore. God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. And Easter Sunday, resurrection, rising from the dead, this is God's testimony to us, saying, look, all of you, look, that's my Son. And I approve of what he did. And people, all people, have got to trust in Christ, he said. That's why we have the resurrection. this morning. All right. Well, we've been told to let out early today because church service is starting early. It starts at 10:30 this morning. So we're going to close, and we'll pick up next week, by the way, back on Philippians. We'll be starting on chapter 2 next week. If you'd like to read ahead. Lord Jesus, we pray to you this morning, Lord, because you've risen from the dead. We pray to you because the grave did not hold you. You rose from the dead, paid for our sins. You've offered us salvation. You live in our hearts and you walk with us every day. Lord, we've got praise and worship for you. We love you. We're nothing without you, Lord. We have no future, no hope, no life. But for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, Lord, you've changed all that. You've given us a future and eternity in heaven with you. Lord, we love you this morning. We love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.